mute the YouTubes when it comes up. Is it weird if I thumbs up our own video?
No, you go for it.
I do like
it. We're not
it.
Proud. We'll take whatever the fuck we can get.
Yeah, absolutely. All right.
Has it started?
Yeah. I done muted it.
There we go.
Cool. We're going to start recording now, Corey. Don't fuck it up.
We'll see.
Welcome to episode 47 of the Podcast Terry production of Galactic Netcasts. This is the podcast about things that make you shit your pants. Or hopefully shit your pants. I'm your host, Matt Stein, and with me as always is Corey, parentheses, Jack Picone Scott. Corey, how are you?
I'm fine. I look enough like Wilford Brimley that I'll help you shit your pants too, kids.
For more on this podcast, including show notes, contact information, subscription links, go to gncast.com/pot. You can also chat with us on our Slack channel during our shows if you go to gncast.com/signup. And while you're there, go ahead and subscribe to our newsletter. Podcast is here, spoiler heavy as fuck. So if you haven't seen the topic that we are going to be discussing, which this week is a garbage heap pile called Leviathan, you may want to go check it out. And Corey wants me to tell you that I swear. So today, tonight, whatever time you're listening to this, we are joined by the host, one of the hosts of Worst Episode Ever in the 90s Percentile, a stand-up comedian superpower, Jack Picone. Jack, how are you?
I'm doing all right. How's it going, Matt and Corey and Jack?
I'm also Jack.
We're good. I wasn't able to be in on the Jackness, but last week we made a couple inside jokes.
Yeah, I guess we should explain that for the half a person listening. I don't know. Do you have decimal?
We're up to 7.
Okay. Corey was on my podcast, 90s Percentile, with Dan Mulhall, my co-host, who would be here, but he's in Japan doing Japanese things. So shout out to Dan. But Corey was on last week. We talked about Jurassic Park and Twin Peaks as well as we could. Corey is a long story. Listen to the podcast. Corey is me. I am Corey. We're one and the same.
And we're all together.
Yeah, Matt, you missed out, but you were on my other podcast with Dan, Worst Episode Ever, the Simpsons podcast, so you don't have to be jealous. That was a great episode.
It's just fun hanging out with you guys. I send you a lot of Facebook messages. Most of them go unanswered. I feel like I'm in the internet bushes outside your window, tapping, ignoring
me. To be fair, the Facebook Messenger app is kind of the bushes outside of my window. I don't check it as often as I check my actual texts.
Yeah, well, see, I don't have your phone number, and I've threatened to give you mine.
That was intentional.
I see how this relationship's going to go.
Right. From what I hear from others, all you'll get is text messages about how much Matt loves you.
Who said that?
Everybody.
What do you mean, everybody?
I mean, the restraining order is a very long list.
Sometimes I get drunk and I text people that I love them, and I mean every word of it.
I would rather a text from you drunk that says I love you than a text from you drunk that says I hate you. That there's something more inherently scary about that.
And sometimes, though, you might just get a text from that says I'm in you.
That happens to Corey, and then he's always like, what? How? Why? Then he's got to figure out how I've inserted myself in him. So this weekend is the weekend that you probably want to start this relationship then, because there's a very good chance I'm going to get drunk tomorrow and on Monday, because America.
Because America.
Are you going to be drinking America?
No. So my buddy and I we play this game. We drink Corona because you put the line.
Not a game.
No, there's a game.
Okay.
Drinking Corona is not a fucking game. When your Corona's gone, you see who can throw the lime out of the bottle the furthest.
Oh, that's fun.
Yeah, so it just used to be a thing, and then the last time we did it, we measured out feet, and we made a scoreboard. So I'm the current lime toss champion with like a 57-foot throw.
I often thought you were a tosser.
I am a tosser. Salads, limes,
rings.
Rings, yeah. Tossing rings. I toss everything.
I wouldn't join in this weekend. Actually, today, we'll see. It's still early. Today might be the first day in 2-3 weeks that I will go without drinking at least one or two beers. I've been on a hell of a streak the last couple of weeks. It's kind of crazy.
Apparently you made a box of beer disappear.
Yeah, very quickly. Very kind enough to send me some local brews.
I love sharing beer, and we all know Dan won't listen because Dan's a dick, so Dan will never know that this box of beer existed.
I told him. I said I drank your beer.
He sent him pictures of you drinking the beer with your dick out. Just say, all right, there you go.
Good times. I guess we should start the shit show. But, oh yeah, I know. I'm equally as crushed as you are, Jack.
I don't want to like make my listeners feel alienated because I love them so much and I love that they love our shows. But I feel like I've been gradually becoming the most reluctant podcast host on the internet, unless you consider like Adnan Syed a podcast host. But like, I feel like it's just become such a grind, and I'm just like, oh God, I have to talk about things that I like. Life is so hard.
I also love our listeners, all 7 of them, but I go through the same streaks where it's just like, oh, do I really have to talk about things that I like or how much I hate them, make fun of things on the internet with some friends of mine? Yeah, you're not alone. Keep up that.
I appreciate that. I do love it. Obviously, I would have stopped by now. Although, if you are going to listen to my worst episode ever podcast, keep in mind we did take like 4 months off. We've just burned out on bad Simpsons episodes. We'll be back in September. But there's like 85 full episodes and 60 deleted scenes episodes. There's plenty to hold you over if you decide to join and listen to us.
You guys were cranking out episodes pretty frequently too, right? It was like 2 a week while your outtakes and your regular episodes.
Yeah, one and a half, 2 with the Simpsons, and then the 90s percentile is also weekly. Yeah, but we're gonna have to slow our output. That was unsustainable.
Yeah, slow your roll. That's what a pro wrestler would say.
I would know.
Yeah, Dan would know if he was here, but Dan's not here, so fuck you, Dan. I guess we'll do some news real quick instead of making fun of Dan for a couple hours. But the first story we have is that Stephen King's It remake has finally begun production. I don't know if either of you have been following this, but I was pretty closely because the original It was probably one of the first horror movies I ever saw.
I know that they've cast like what, Justin Bieber or somebody as the clown. It's as Pennywise. It's some pretty boy.
Yeah, he's like 14. He's a Skarsgård. I don't know what that means, but.
What the fuck is his name? In addition to Skarsgård, the film boasts Jaden Lieberher.
Yeah.
Who are you?
I don't know. Can't they just use like hologram Tim Curry and hologram Jonathan Brandis?
You'd think.
Is that the fuck to ask? No, I've actually never seen or read it, actually. I only know a little bit of it. I've seen bits and pieces of the movie.
It's a good movie. I mean, we watched it not too long ago, and it still holds up.
Yeah, for being made for television into a rather lengthy film. I mean, it was 2 parts, and I think that's what they're planning on doing for this, too, because they have the part that takes place when they're kids, and then they have the part where it takes place when they're adults. And what, the TV one had, was John Ritter in it? And
yeah, John Ritter. The
Little
dad
John from the Waltons.
Yeah. Tim something. I know he was in this other movie. I made for TV movie called Trucks, which was pretty much a movie remake of Maximum Overdrive, which is one of my favorite movies, and I was just obsessed with both of them.
Yeah, Maximum Overdrive is actually a much more enjoyable film for me.
You guys watch shitty movies.
Maximum Overdrive is badass. I feel
like you're watching movies wrong, I think, is the correct statement.
Is nude, sweaty on my couch the wrong way to watch movies?
Yeah, that's the wrong way to watch school children.
I am pretty close to a school, but I really like the leather when it peels off my skin.
Oh, so you're talking about movie theaters. You're not talking about your couch.
No, I have a leather couch.
Oh, okay.
I can't go to a movie theater nude because that's how you get the restraining orders.
So I know. That's how I filed it.
the sweaty leather man's in my bushes again. Feel free to call me the sweaty leather man from now on.
I think that should be your new title.
Sweaty leather man.
Sweaty leather man.
God forbid I ever get to introduce the goddamn show and give Matt a fucking nickname at the opening.
Fine, you can do the next one.
I don't really want that kind of pressure.
See? No one wants all that pressure.
I let Dan do it for the Simpsons podcast. That's work to me. That's not the fun part of podcasting. He can do all the Twitters and websites and all that. I feel like you're benefiting from that, Corey.
Yeah, I feel like it sometimes. I just sit back and let the shit happen.
Just watch the car crash happen.
Just described a sexual assault. All right, so...
I don't know, there's a bunch of assholes in this movie, too, that I've never heard of. All of them look like Justin Bieber and give the duck face.
Well, they're all little kids. Now, the question is that this is obviously for the first part. Have they cast or are they casting any of the adults besides the clown rapist?
I don't know. Well, wouldn't it be cool if they made the movies like 15, 20 years apart and kept the whole cast?
Battle Boy?
Is that what a Battle Boy is going to do?
I think that's what it was.
Are they going to do About a Man? Oh, yeah. You're talking about Boyhood.
Boyhood, that's what it was.
Yeah. I mean, that's one movie, but I guess you could do it as one movie. But I'm saying, what if you just hold off on It Volume 2 for another 20, 25 years? Hope that none of these child actors kill themselves.
Yeah, that and, well, I mean, at that point, I guess it would be pretty easy to recast 15 years later. But also just, like, push them out into bad situations of, like, no, these kids had a rough life, and we want you to experience that. So when you come back for the film, you look world-hardened. So here you are in Richmond, and here you are in Detroit.
I think there's something to it. I think that it could be the boyhood of terror, the boyhood of horror movies.
If not, we need to make that happen. There needs to be a Boyhood of Terror.
that sounds
really
bad idea.
I feel like we're all about to get restraining orders.
Yeah, Corey's going to go out to a school and be like, hey, come here, little boy. I want to film you.
I live streets away from a school.
I'm down the street from a Catholic church. I could get you a boy.
Yeah, but we know those kids are broken in. We don't want that. We want...
Whoa.
No, never mind. This conversation's done.
Wait, so...
Jack, tell us about Hitler.
No. I was trying not to bring that up today.
That reminds me, though, I wanted to bring something up at the top of the show. Matt, you mentioned that Corey wanted you to mention that there is swearing on the show. Corey, do you on your other podcast, or do you have do you not swear? Do you have clean acts?
No, we definitely swear on Elsewhere's, which is the other show I do regularly. I just find it's nice to let people know up front, especially because at one point Matt had done an episode with us where we didn't swear.
And we did one. Labeled it as a family-friendly episode, but if you're too dense to realize that the red E that shows up on iTunes means that I say fuck a lot, you deserve to hear some dirty words.
I just felt like we're telling kids it's okay to come listen to this episode in the midst of us doing all of this horrible shit that we do every other week. If they come to us for one episode and then they go to the next one and suddenly we're like, fuck this and balls that and sweaty anal hemorrhoids, they might be taken aback. So if we could just give them the warning.
If they're not going to hear it from us, they're going to hear it on the streets.
From us.
From us.
Honestly, I think it's misleading, and maybe you should change the name of your podcast. I think Disney's Podcast of Terror is just you're opening up some expectations. Maybe lose the Disney's.
We tried to get sponsorship, but when I see Matt sing I Want to Be a Part of Your World to small kids around the Disney studio lot, it just makes it really hard for me to enjoy The Little Mermaid in a sexual way anymore.
Oh, God, Corey, you just really... I have no words for you right now.
Well, I think the words you want to say are our next story.
Sure. There's shit for news this week, so I was looking at the list of movies that Amazon and Hulu and Netflix are all releasing, and I thought to myself, hey, here's some pretty good movies. Let's talk about that.
Yeah. Netflix is going to release the entire Lethal Weapon franchise, which, if people haven't watched them, they should, because those movies are fucking amazing. Even the shitty ones, even 3 and 4.
They made a 4.
Oh, yeah. The fourth one has Chris Rock in it.
And Jet Li.
Wait, isn't that just Rush Hour with a different Asian?
Is it not the same Asian? Am I that racist? I don't know.
Well, actually, Lethal Weapon 4 is a very racist movie. Mel Gibson, this was before everybody knew he was racist. He has some very questionable lines about the Asian villains.
Oh, boy. Does he call them zipperheads?
Maybe. I mean, there's one scene where he beats up a bunch of Chinese guys, and then he's, like, all hurting the next day, and Rene Russo's like, what's wrong? And he's like, bad Chinese. There's another one where they break into a Chinese food restaurant, and he's, like, harassing the manager, who is a mobster. And he's just like, do you have any fried rice? And then the guy goes, it's fried rice, you plick. And it's just like, where's Gary Busey when you need him?
I kind of wish that there would have been a fight scene in which Mel Gibson's just yelling Chinese dishes while he hits a guy.
That might be a scene, actually.
He just winds up with Mugu Gai Pen.
There's lots of racist stuff.
Now I'm gonna have to watch that.
Yeah. You should. It's a very watered down version of a Lethal Weapon movie, but it's still a Lethal Weapon movie. It's very fun. It's funny because the whole point is, oh my God, they've gotten so old. It's 11 years after the original. Mel Gibson's in his late 40s, and now that movie was 18, 19 years ago. Which is much further from 4 from 1. It's, you know, time is a flat circle.
That's true. I hope they put out Lethal Weapon 5.
They were supposed to, but I don't think it's going to happen because in September, the Fox is releasing the Lethal Weapon TV series with Damon Wayans as Murtaugh.
Because the Rush Hour TV series that came out on CBS recently did so well.
I forgot that was a thing.
And the Beverly Hills Cop series that didn't even make it to air.
Yeah.
And it had Eddie Murphy in it, so you know it had to have been horrible if they're like, oh, no, we can't show this to anybody.
But they are working on a Beverly Hills Cop 4, apparently, right now.
That would be great.
Cinema. Because Bronson Pinchot needs help. He needs your love.
He's the flamboyant ARP representative.
Right.
Yeah, movies are like a hollow shell of what they used to be.
Yeah.
Rebooting movies that are 15, 20 years old, sometimes 5 years old, sequels to movies that don't need sequels.
Yeah, I bet you there's some good movies out there. I wouldn't know because I haven't had time to go to the movies. I wanted to see Green Room. I've heard a lot of good things about that.
Oh, yeah, that's someone else told me to watch that one. The 3-hour unedited rated R version of Batman vs. Superman has been leaked on the internet, and apparently it's really good.
Really?
Yeah.
Apparently, it's an improvement. I think after you go through being tortured with bamboo shoots underneath your testicles, you feel like, hey, this time they're just using regular chopsticks. I feel that this is both in line with a racist Lethal Weapon movie and better for me. So I love it.
Have you watched it?
I have not.
I watched the original one, and it was not good. And some of the bigger faults of it still stick around. Like, it all hinges on our moms have the same name.
I did see it. I haven't seen the new unedited one. I actually am, in some respects, not completely, a defender of Man of Steel. I actually think it's an underrated movie. Or at least it doesn't deserve a lot of the flack it gets. So I was going into Batman vs. Superman, and I really liked Ben Affleck. So I really thought this movie could work for me, and I was just... my girlfriend refuses to go to see any more comic book movies now. It broke her.
Oh, man.
I guess this is an opportunity to plug some of the shit that you do, but you have a sync point for Man of Steel, right?
That's right. We do a movie commentary series. Right now we've got 4 movies out. We do them fairly infrequently. And for Batman vs. Superman, we did 2. We did back-to-back. We did Batman, the 89 Tim Burton movie, and we did Superman Returns. I wanted to do Man of Steel because I wanted to defend it against people who really hated it, but it wasn't streaming anywhere. Superman Returns was.
So. Oh, Superman Returns. Okay. Corey, by the way, I'm going to actually call out Jack on air. But I told them we should do a Halloween sync points with them. We get 75% of all the proceeds. That he was not aware about until right now.
I'm sure that that's working. He's sitting there doing the math in his head, and he goes, that's totally worth my time and investment.
So you would get about $1.50. Okay.
75% of zero is still zero.
Then I suggest we donate it to charity.
Which charity? How will we decide which charity gets none of our money?
D's Nuts.
D's Nuts. I'm going to get a big check. Just write D's Nuts. Here's 50 cents to be made from talking about movies on the internet. Nuts. Already released on Netflix. Well, actually, by the time you hear this, most of these will be out because we're recording very far in advance because I want to celebrate America without pants on. Rosemary's Baby, Saw 6 and 7. Wishmaster 1 through 4. Stir of Echoes, which is a really good movie. And then apparently they made a sequel to that in 2007.
Well, these are on Amazon. This is the list for Amazon. You have to go to other pages to get the Netflix ones. And the Hulu, Hulu. So,
click on them, except Microsoft Edge has fucked me again.
Big Trouble in Little China just hit Netflix. Blade 2, Death Race 2, the 2010 sequel to the Death Race. And then, Death Race 3 Inferno. We're going the gamut with fucking Death Race movies. Pandemic, Twisted, The Invitation, the thing that I'm looking forward to most on Netflix, and I was going to get with you about doing this later on, is there's a new show coming out called Stranger Things. It has Winona Ryder in it, and it looks like a mix of what we expected from the J.J. Abrams film, was it High Eight?
Super Eight.
Super Eight. It's kind of got that look of like Goonies, except in sort of a horror setting, and maybe reminds me a little bit of when the kids found the alien meathead in Meatballs 2. Anybody ever watch that movie? I'm sorry. I apologize.
Is Winona Ryder playing the sloth in this Goonies?
No, she's playing the mother of the child who disappears.
She's a little old for.
Yeah, the trailer looks really good because she's the mom. The kid disappears. All his friends are like, where did he go? And she goes and talks to a cop, and the cop's like, well, 99% of the time, it turns out the kid's just with a friend and they return. She's like, yeah, but what about the other 1%? Well, obviously, that's why we occupy Wall Street. So it's getting a lot of good buzz. Netflix has been really killing AOD lately with their original stuff. And then for you, Matt, over on Hulu, the very first picture they show on the screen is from the movie that you just mentioned recently, Little Monsters. And it is the most rapey picture I've ever seen, and probably the only frightening thing from Little Monsters. And it's Fred Savage and Howie Mandel's demon character. Howie Mandel is laying atop a young boy in a bed, has this giant grin on his face, and Fred Savage just looking at him like, yeah, get it. Like your face right now.
That's not even a scene from the movie. That was just like a casual photographer on set took that in between takes.
This is how we got it produced.
How we lay on top of this kid. Fred, look at him all lovingly. Let's take some pictures.
That's actually what a hockey shocker is.
What?
Bobby's World? Come on.
Bobby's World. That's. Oh, man.
Hockey shockers, Bobbo. Never mind. Go fuck yourself.
No, didn't you guys just talk about Bobby's World recently on 90s Percentile?
You know, I couldn't tell you because it's amazing how everything we talk about on air just goes in one ear and out the other. Like, I don't retain any of it. And I edit heavily our Simpsons podcast, so I do re-listen to them, and I get an idea of, oh, this is what happened on the show. I kind of remember this. But I don't edit 90s Percentile. It is pretty much live to card. So we have a comment section. We have a very vibrant Reddit community, and everybody's like talking about these conversations that we had, and I'm just like, oh, I have no idea what they're talking about. I don't remember. I can only your episode was on Monday. We recorded it 2 weeks ago, and I can only remember broad strokes of what we discussed. Like,
is a broad stroke like a slow jerk?
Yes, it is. It's exactly like that.
But it involves multiple partners. I will just remind you that my episode was epic, and you should have me on again.
Well, you were great because I do listen to the very beginning and the very end of the show, and I actually was laughing out loud.
Funny, Corey, when you left. It was the best moment the show has ever had.
I'm starting to think that we just have Jack on our podcast to like talk to him about doing other things on the podcast. We should really do this on your podcast, but have us on.
And make sure you get the percentages of how much you guys are going to get paid. Make sure you get that in the conversation on air.
Yeah, 75%. You keep up the bullshit, we're going to push it to 80. I might just own your studio apartment by the time we're done with this.
You can take it. Take my debt, please.
You can have. Well, you want to trade?
Maybe we'll see how the apocalyptic New York gets. Maybe I might need to get out of Dodge.
Hey man, I told you I got space. You can come mow my lawn,
and then live on it. So here's kind of a fucked up thing to notice: is Hulu has Saw 4 and Saw the Final Chapter, but as you just mentioned, Saw 6 and 5 are going over to another one of the services. That's just bullshit. You can't even follow Saw easily. It's like I have to chase the Saw sequels around. You know what's wrong with my life?
What's bullshit is that I own them all on DVD.
That is kind of bullshitty.
Yeah.
I've never seen any of them besides the first one in the theater.
Don't.
I have yet to see any of the sequels.
No, you can just punch yourself in the crotch. It's the same thing. There's nothing good about them.
Would I make the same face that Carrie Yules? Is that how you say it? Carrie Yules?
No.
Elway?
What face Carrie is the star?
The star of the first one, when he's crying desperately as he cuts his foot off, he makes that horrible contorted face.
Yeah, I think he's crying because he's doing as shitty of an American accent as what Robin Hood Prince of Thieves had is the English accent with Kevin Costner that he got to make fun of when he did Men in Tights.
Yeah.
See, I'm waiting for Jack to make the face.
Oh,
do it. There it is.
That's so pretty.
Oh, God.
Yeah, that could be your screen grab.
So the problem is I talked, so then Hangouts switched to a big ass of my face, and you're just small in the corner, so.
Nobody puts
like to see Matt's big ass face. Go onto youtube.com/galacticneckass.
Sweaty leatherhead.
Sweaty leatherhead.
Sweaty leather face. Yeah, we'll get there.
The last news story I got this week is that Left 4 Dead 3 is apparently a thing. Jack, you
really?
Video games, but not really.
Oh no, a huge Left 4 Dead fan. Love the first two games.
Yeah, there was a screen capture that a Valve employee released, and they have a folder called Left 4 Dead 3.
That's really exciting, except I'm really disappointed because I keep every month, every paycheck, every 2 weeks, I keep trying to do the math and figure out how I'm going to buy a next-gen console, an Xbox One or a PS4, and it's just, I really thought I would have one by now. It's just every time I'm like, all right, this is it. This is July. This is one of 2 months a year where we get, if you're paid every 2 weeks, you get three paychecks in a month.
Yep.
So theoretically, I should have an extra. So I've been waiting for this paycheck just yesterday to finally bite the bullet, and I was just like, oh, wait, I'm still horribly in debt. I need to eat. I have no idea when I'm going to – it's not even on the horizon, especially because now I want to get the new Xbox One and the new PS4. Why bother getting the old one if it's not going to be able to run the games?
Very true. I'm curious.
I really want to play Left 4 Dead 3, though. Oh, man. The some of my all-time favorite games, those first two.
So it apparently doesn't come out until 2017, so you got some time.
Yeah, that's what I said in 2014.
Well,
About Uncharted 4.
Uncharted 4 was really good.
Yeah, I'm sure it was.
Well, if you get a PS4, you can borrow my Uncharted 4.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
And when you get it back, it will have a slice of bologna in it.
That's a reference. I do remember. See, I completely forgot about that. I got into some deep personal family stuff on our Corey's episode of 90s Percentile.
And you can say it, Jack. It meant more to me than it meant to you. I understand. I knew what this was when I went in.
You guys have sex?
We did. We
take the silence as a yes.
Okay, I guess you're part of every rape culture ever.
Me or Jack?
You. I'll take the silence as a yes. Thank you, Bill Cosby.
God. Oh, that was a dirty joke.
Yeah, I know it was.
She can't say no if she can't talk.
Oh, jeez.
I felt really bad saying that. So that's all I really got for news. I guess my eyes were raped this morning watching this Leviathan film. Jack.
So I guess you guys didn't actually enjoy. Should we talk about what this movie is, Leviathan? Or should we talk about the plot or whatever? Or do you want me to say why I picked it?
All of the above. You have to describe it because you made me watch it, and now I'm mad at you.
I've seen it. I think it's one of those things I used to watch on HBO when I was a kid a lot.
Yes, exactly.
Not a kid so much, but it used to be on all the time, and I'd watch it all the time.
Yeah, see, that's why I picked it. I mean, this might surprise you guys. I'm a little neurotic. When you guys invited me to be on the show, I freaked out about what movie to pick because so many options. So I went with Leviathan because not a lot of people know about it and not a lot of people have seen it, but it's definitely a movie I've seen a bunch on TV growing up, and it used to scare the shit out of me as a little kid. And it also has Peter Weller in it, and Peter Weller is one of my favorite people ever because he's just... I actually rewatched last night. I couldn't sleep. I watched all of his scenes in Star Trek Into Darkness. Just because, and he just anytime he's on screen, I'm just captivated. He's just so badass.
He was born in Stevens Point, Wisconsin, which is about an hour west of me.
Oh, that's awesome! I never even thought to look up where he's from. Is everybody from that town just like a deep throated badass?
No, it's a college town, so there's a lot of pricks.
Oh.
Yeah, the only reason that he moved away, actually, is because one night he received a text from Matt that said, I'm inside of you.
Peter.
I told him just to stick with the Facebook Messenger. I said, don't give him your number. You're going to regret it.
And this was long before text existed, so Peter Weller was really confused when he took out his bag full and there was birds on it.
He's a futurist. He played, if your listeners don't know, and then they're probably listening to the wrong podcast, he played RoboCop. So,
in a sci-fi podcast, because we're all straight males that listen to this.
RoboCop transcends genres. RoboCop is just everybody. It should be like when you have to sign your draft card at 18. Everybody should have to watch RoboCop at some point.
And then you go off into space and fight space bugs.
I love Starship Troopers. I think that's up there, but not as perfect as RoboCop. So Leviathan it's 1989. It's pretty much The Thing, but underwater.
Mixed with Alien/Aliens.
Yeah, exactly. I told Matt that it was The Thing meets the Abyss, and then when I was rewatching, I was like, no, it's much more The Thing meets Alien. It's very similar. You know, the working class miners aboard an isolated ship and picked off one by one by this gruesome creature.
My wife actually stopped and said, is this a prequel to The Thing? I'm like, well, no. First of all, The Thing, as you know, was a remake anyways, so long transcends this.
But the new thing, the remake of The Thing, is a prequel to the 83 thing.
Yep.
Okay. All I know is that Daniel Stern is your pre-racist comment.
Oh, and then I was like, yeah, Richard Crenna is in this movie from First Blood, Peter Weller, and then I told you Chris Elliott was in it. And Chris Elliott's not in this movie. Apparently, I was conflating other alt-comic 80s, 90s star Daniel Stern, who plays Marvin Home Alone, with The Abyss, which does have Chris Elliott in a few scenes. And for some reason, my brain merged them, much like the characters in this movie get merged into a single Stan Winston horror monster.
Yeah, it was a really slow-moving movie, in my opinion.
I like slow. I don't mind slow movies.
This is an era when we could wait for the plot to temper and thicken. This is not Michael Bay's deep-sea fishing. This is something a little bit better.
There definitely were not enough cars blowing up in this movie.
love a Michael Bay... like underwater horror movie with cars just randomly blowing up for no fucking reason. How can we use that footage of the car driving to the street that we used in The Island and Transformers? I don't know, make it happen. Michael Bay, motherfucker!
Megan Fox is playing some kind of Kraken, yet she still, he manages to get a shot of her straddling a motorcycle in a bikini.
It's just, her toe thumbs are the Kraken.
No, I'm surprised that you guys didn't like the movie at all. Because it's kind of bland, it's kind of boring, it's not at all revolutionary, but I was surprised rewatching it for the first time as an adult how competent it was, where pretty much every character, I was never yelling at the screen like, this character shouldn't be doing what they're doing. I thought it was fairly well written. Characters were clearly defined. They were all doing exactly what you would expect them to do. The closest thing to a villain besides the monster is Richard Crenna's doctor, and you can even relate to him. Basically, he traps them down there, but for a good cause. He doesn't want this monster to spread to the mainland.
He tries to save humanity. I mean, his character is basically sitting there, and he's talking about things that he's done in his life that has helped people, but he's kind of gotten shit because he had one screw-up, and now he's stuck in this underwater trap of, you know, this is what his life has become. But he does the most noble thing of, like, yeah, we're all going to have to die here because you can't let this out.
Yeah, that's what I was surprised. There was a surprising depth to these characters for this pretty much run-of-the-mill. And this was a big-budget blockbuster-type movie. It bombed, but it was a big AAA release at the time. But even the Doctor was a really well drawn out character, but so was Peter Weller. He was basically the captain of the ship, but he didn't know how to be a manager. You see him reading like a middle management book and practicing in the mirror how he's going to yell at his subordinates. I thought it was a really cool idea. It's a shame the movie didn't have underwater exploding cars, I guess, but it did lack in thrills. But I was surprised at how everything else about the movie, usually when you watch a really bad movie from the 80s, it's a really bad movie from the 80s.
Well, I fully expected the end to be where they finally get to the surface, and then that's how Leviathan 2 would start, because the monster's on land. But it was
the biggest problem of the movie was, for some reason, they threw a shark scene at the end.
Yeah, exactly. Like, what kind of fucking day are we having?
Yeah.
I mean, all right, okay, now back to, let's just accept, we're going to call it our Mel Gibson comment. So they do get out, they rise up to the surface. It was the three characters, Elizabeth, Peter Weller, Steven, and then Ernie Hudson's Justin. Now, the creature pops out of the water, presumably kills Justin, but all I saw was Justin not able to swim. And is that a racial comment? I don't even feel like the monster did anything to him. He just sort of sank, and then no one gave a shit about going back for him.
Yeah, and the Wikipedia article said that he sacrificed himself to save them. I was like, no, he didn't. He just kind of stood there.
I mean, he did yell, like, to Peter Weller to just stay back. I remember hearing him say that, but I kind of think he was maybe trying to use the monster as a flotation device.
Now, that's so we thought the monster is dead. It comes back for one last scare and unfortunately kills Ernie Hudson. He didn't have his proton pack, I guess. And so if you're going to do this last-minute scare and this reappearance of this monster, which makes sense, even though it died, it can regenerate, it can come back up, why bother with the shark? You don't need the. If the monster was dead and you have nothing left, okay, maybe you throw a shark in there and it's just a really bad day. But why have the shark and then the last-minute scare?
Right.
What were they thinking?
I guess it's just like, well, we're in the water. People like sharks. Let's throw some sharks in here. We don't have them do a goddamn thing, but we'll just have them there for a second.
And the movie was, like I said, I really liked the movie, and then the shark scene took me out. I was like, that's weird. And then they double down on that, because now Peter Weller and, what was her name, Samantha?
Williams.
Elizabeth Williams. They survive. They make it to the oil rig, you know, to safety. And then he punches a woman in the face and knocks her out cold.
Meg Foster, who's basically playing the same bitch she played in They Live.
Yeah, yeah. And it's just like, she did leave them to die, but Peter Weller just punched a woman in the face.
She left them to die in the sense of, like, yeah, they reported them all dead, but then they're sending out helicopters to go find him.
Yeah, they didn't, like, gun him, you know, they didn't shoot him and hide the bodies. Yeah, it's so weird that the movie it literally ends with Peter Weller punching her in the face, knocking her out cold, smiling and saying, like, I feel better now, and then it just cuts to black.
Yeah, and that's right after he does the big action scene of, I'm going to throw a grenade in the mouth of this. I'm going to swim over to it when I don't have to and throw a grenade in its mouth and do some fucking Arnold Schwarzenegger, like, grunt. And I just...
it kind of fell apart in the last 5 minutes there. But, I like the idea. I mean, it wasn't original. It was Alien, mining colony, one by one, being picked off. It was a creepy movie, though, and basically they do communicate with Meg Foster via satellite throughout the movie, and it reminded me of Oblivion, the Tom Cruise movie, where they keep talking to the Academy Award-winning actress. Also starts with an M, but I can't think of her name. But where there's just something cool about a character that you only see on a TV screen every 15 minutes in the movie. A lot of these sci-fi tropes, I was just really bought into the whole world of it. I'm surprised this movie isn't more well-known. I'm not saying it's amazing, but I'm surprised, and I'm surprised that you didn't like it as much. Yeah, I thought maybe you'd just be like, okay, that was okay. That was
no,
fine.
No, first of all, stop confusing me for Matt, because Matt shits on everything. I enjoy this movie for the most part. I think that there are problems with it, but like I said, I watched it when I was younger, and it was one of those things that I'd leave on all the time. Probably because I had a sort of semi-big crush on Lisa Elbacher. Yeah, and Ernie Hudson, too. You know, if there's a steady paycheck in it, he'll say whatever I want. So
is that the one from Beverly Hills Cop?
From Beverly Hills Cop, yeah.
There's something cute about her.
Well, I think it goes back, for me, even earlier when she was on Nancy Drew.
Oh, wow.
She was on the old Nancy Drew series in the 70s and everything, so...
By the way, guys, the Nancy Drew pilot that CBS just made did not get picked up. 35-year-old homicide detective Nancy Drew reboot.
Yes.
For some reason, didn't take off.
It's because she can't double hack a back door with six people typing on one keyboard.
God damn it. The director... Let's jump back. The director of this, George P. Cosmatos? That's a fucking fun name anyways. did Tombstone.
Yeah, isn't that crazy?
Right after this did Tombstone, which is a great goddamn movie. Also did Cobra and Rambo First Blood Part 2.
Yeah.
Which are not good.
Probably my least favorite Rambo movie, but that's okay.
My least favorite Rambo movie is also Cobra.
Why isn't Rambo First Blood Part 2 just called Rambo Second Blood?
They wanted to tie it into the name of First Blood, but they wanted to completely distinguish it from being a good movie by saying, oh, by the way, we're just going to call this one Rambo.
And then Rambo 3 is just Rambo 3, even though it should technically be First Blood 3.
Yeah, Third Blood.
And then there's Two Rambo, Two Furious.
Two Rambo, Two Furious. Rambo 8.
I wanted to see Rambo 5. They teased it at the end of the new Rambo, and apparently it's not going to happen.
Well, Stallone's pretty old.
That's not stopping Stallone.
Yeah, he's old, but he could probably still beat all three of us up at the same time.
And we would pay him for it.
Yeah. Mr. Stallone, will you kick me in the genitals?
Okay.
Okay. It might just be me. Maybe I'm the only one that wants a good... kicking the old balls.
I would pay Stallone to kick you in the genitals as well.
No. You got to pay him to kick you in the genitals.
I mean, I would pay him my portion of the 75% that we're going to take.
I'll write my I'll sign over my check for my sync points earnings to use to Mr. Stallone.
Mr. Stallone, we're going to give you this check, but it's in care of these nuts.
It's post-dated. You're going to want to hang on to that
one. Now it makes sense why the charity is called These Nuts.
It all comes full circle. So apparently, this is now a Rambo podcast, but the last Rambo movie was supposed to be called Last Blood.
That would have been cool.
No, it would have been even dumber that there was First Blood Part 2, Rambo 3, Rambo, and then Last Blood. It should be
Last Blood would have been Rambo against vampires.
I also thought Rambo should have been the new Rambo that came out in 2007. Should have been called John Rambo, because it was Stallone's, he wrote and directed it directly after writing and directing Rocky Balboa, so he might as well, he should have called it John Rambo and been like, this is the Rocky Balboa of Rambo movies.
Or, what if Rocky and Rambo got together and had a baby, and then he made John Balboa, and...
Oh, they're going to call him Rockbo.
Rockbo. Rockbo. Boxer by day, murderous assassin by night.
I'd watch it.
I'd watch it, too. I'd watch it twice. Stallone, get on that, because we now have 8 listeners. Sylvester Stallone is the 8th one.
I always thought the human mind was the most dangerous weapon.
I heard I could kick somebody in the nuts.
And he teams up with the robot that they gave Polly in part four.
Happy birthday, Polly.
Maybe Stallone will pick up our Gremlins 3.5 idea, too.
Yeah, see? Oh, man, Gremlins, our period World War II Gremlins 3.5 film written and directed by Sylvester Stallone. I think we've got a winner.
I really think this is how we launch ourselves to superstardom.
One of the Gremlins should be named Rockbo.
Rockbo? Rockbo the Gremlin?
Well, I mean, they did do the Rambo reference in part two.
Yes, yes.
So it's got to be a good continuation. I'm just trying to figure out how I'm going to masturbate to it. Or stop masturbating.
Well, if Stallone's veins are in it, that's all I need.
There his goes arm, Stallone.
His arm veins. His arm veins remind me of my penis veins.
He's starting to look more like Estelle Getty, and his mom will shoot. And so
now that's not a bad idea. He should do a remake of that where he's the dad, like Stop or My Dad Will Shoot, and you get like a young hip cop played by the probably
35-year-old Nancy. Nancy Drew.
I think you got something there.
I think I got one. I don't think I've ever seen Stop or My Mom Will Shoot. I don't think I've ever seen it.
You're not missing anything.
The tagline is, she did the laundry, washed the dishes, now she's cleaning up the streets.
Somebody paid millions of dollars to make that movie. Isn't that someone fascinating? Paid a
lot. Yeah, and someone actually said, you know what Stallone's best movie was? Oh. Rhinestone. We should do another comedy with Sylvester Stallone and just someone who you would not picture with him up on screen.
Do you have any guesses at what the budget was on that movie?
$36 million.
Corey?
No, I would imagine a box of Chiclets.
But I'm factoring in 90% of the budget is going to Stallone's and salary.
Whoever's going to wipe his ass for him.
It is $45 million.
In 1992 bucks.
Yep. I got to get to the internet. Inflation calculator. We don't like giving out false information on our show.
$6 trillion. It was our generation's Cleopatra.
This came out in 92.
We'll wait.
Oh, yeah. No,
we're good.
Everyone be real quiet while I figure this out.
We're on the edge of our seats, Matt.
Oh, you can't do it. It says, please enter a value less than $10 million.
Stop or my mat will stall.
Can you just enter $10 million and then multiply it by 4.5?
You just ask Siri. Where's my phone? Oh, my phone.
Oh, I'm just going to do $4.5 million and add a zero.
Oh, there you go.
$77 million.
That wig budget, that Estelle Getty wig budget was up there.
Michael Bay directs and Megan Fox plays Estelle Getty's part getting on a motorcycle.
A car just explodes while she's doing the laundry in the first
Stallone scene. Tries to poop and then a car just blows up in the bathroom.
Wait, besides, so we got off track with Rambo. What was it? You said Rambo Tombstone. There was another interesting movie you mentioned that he had also directed. What was the other one? Oh, Cobra.
Cobra.
Yeah, so he seemed to be a pretty prominent Hollywood director. And then, well,
after Tombstone, two more movies and he just disappeared. He did Joe Bob's Drive-In Theater, an episode of the TV series.
Was that the TNT series?
I believe so. And then it was the episode about more girls with big guns. That was in 95. And in 97, he did something called Shadow Conspiracy and disappeared into the night.
Ooh, I think he stumbled onto some kind of real conspiracy and they had to take him out.
Yeah, or he tried to swim with Ernie Hudson and Ernie used him as a flotation device and that was all she wrote.
By the way, that actually Leviathan monster that eats Ernie Hudson... I don't know if you guys ever watched Power Rangers, the original iteration of it, but the monster totally looked like Piranus, which was a piranha monster from season 2. I know this because I had the action figure, and it was basically just like an evil fish head with sharp teeth.
It was just a repaint of the Leviathan monster from the unreleased toy line.
They just covered up Daniel Stern's face in the torso area, that's all. Right.
They left Richard Crenna there because you can't fuck with perfection.
Richard Crenna was a fucking badass in this movie.
Richard Crenna is a badass in general. I mean, that guy, like, he appears and you're just like, Holy shit. As soon as he walked on the screen, like, Peter Weller already I'm okay with. Amanda Pays I like for Max Headroom in the Flash TV series. But when Richard Crenna walked in the room, I'm like, oh, yeah, now there's some fucking gravitas here.
Yep. Yeah, and his Dr. K is probably my favorite character of the movie. And by the way, Richard Crenna, if you don't know, he's from Rambo. He's pretty much the only guy who could talk a crazy, crazy, insane Rambo, like a First Blood Rambo. Just talk him down and be like, dude, you gotta check yourself.
But can't talk down the people who are sending people after Rambo and like, well, if you're gonna go after Rambo, there's one thing you're gonna need:
it's rock,
a load of body bags.
It's rock paper scissors. Basically, he can talk down. He outdoes Rambo. Rambo outdoes Brian Dennehy. Brian Dennehy outdoes Richard Crenna. It's a checks and balances system.
You know, no one can do better than Brian Dennehy.
Also, Brian Dennehy's still around. Except for if they had Last Blood, they should have brought him back.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. God damn it. And Michael Carmine's in this. Michael Carmine, who the only thing that I can ever say I saw Michael Carmine in was Batteries Not Included.
Yeah. And he was good in this too. Everybody was good. Everybody was...
Hector Elizondo, when he took the Leviathan creature and, you know, helped it pretty itself up so it could have sex with Richard Gere but feel good about itself, I thought that was a beautiful moment.
I didn't realize that. This might be a different Michael Carmine. It actually probably is. Because this guy died in 89.
Of AIDS, yeah.
Oh, okay, that's the same. Okay, because I was like, he must have died right after this movie came out.
Pretty much, yeah.
I didn't realize he was in Band of the Hand. Now I'm, like, really going nuts. That's awesome.
What's that?
Band of the Hand is, like, this weird 80s movie about a group of teens that get together and kind of, like, fight off. They're juvenile criminals that sent away from prison in the Everglades for survival training under the Indian Joe.
Yeah, terrible.
It's weird. It's just like one of those bizarre 80s movies where they get a bunch of teen kids together and then they fight crime.
Oh, I would love to watch that movie. Maybe next podcast if you guys have me.
Lauren Holly's in it.
Why does Jack pick such shitty movies?
I don't know. It's not even a horror movie, but it's just like... We'll create a show. We'll create a show just so we can sit and talk about random-ass movies like Rambo and stuff with Jack.
Well, let's be realistic. How long have we actually talked about the movie collectively between the two episodes that Jack has been on?
Well, do your inflation Googling.
Did my inflation Googling for 6 months ago to now, 57.
I think if we did a pie chart of my appearances on Podcast of Terror, we would have something like 15% movie talk.
Dick talk.
Yes, yeah, so dick talk, shooting the shit. I think there'd be a good 37% of Matt Stein condescension. I think that would be a big piece of the pie.
Yeah, I mean, Matt is basically, he wrecks the curve for everything.
It's because of my massive dong.
That's right. That's where everybody's condescension powers come from.
His dick is so big, we have to berate him. That's what I told myself. Every time I get in a bed, my wife's like, why is it still so small?
Oh, God. Well, she's saying that. She's wishful thinking. She wants it smaller because she's, it's less of a burden for her.
She doesn't believe in God, but she prays every night that it grows. We should probably move on.
I was going to make some comment about magic beans, but I'm done.
I know my name's Jack, but keep me away from that beanstalk, please.
Oh, God.
I got a beanstalk for you.
Grind your boner to make my bread.
My penis. Why are we here again?
Leviathan.
I pick terrible movies, and now you're making me want to pick Jack the Giant Killer, the Bryan Singer movie for a podcast of terror, or for our new miscellaneous movie podcast.
Podcast of miscellaneous movies.
Because Jack and the Beanstalk, Jack the Giant Killer was terrible. Terrible movie.
I would watch whatever you want to watch.
That's what she said.
I know, that makes me sound like, I just want to hang out, Jack. I'll watch whatever you want to watch, just don't leave.
You do, because you're looking in through the bushes, and you really don't have a choice. It would be really funny if, while stalking me, you got a remote from my Sony Bravia, and you were just why does it keep going to the wrestling? What's going on?
But if you randomly get a Facebook message asking what model TV you have. Can you tell me the serial number for your TV real quick?
Can you quick just input code 0000?
Push 0 37 times on your remote. Wait 10 seconds. Push 1, 2, 7, 5, 9. Power twice. Input 3 times. 0 7 more times. And just let me know when you're done.
At which point was he supposed to ejaculate?
He'll do that when he's ready.
That's my Konami code. Down, down, B, B, A, B, finger in my butt.
That's my come on me code.
Yeah, there it is.
Select X butthole. Like in the IT crowd, the 99999 number, it's all long.
This is why I tell people at the beginning of the show that we swear that is the least that we're going to do that's going to offend people.
I really like that clean episode they did. I hope they don't talk about cum codes. That's the one thing I don't want to accidentally stumble upon.
But that would be important because that episode was about a video game, and this is the most relevant thing we've gone to since then.
Can we just ruin video games for everybody?
As much as possible.
Can we make that our goal for this episode?
I just picture like some little old lady sitting down and be like, I really liked Five Nights at Freddy's. Let's listen to this Leviathan movie.
Oh, Richard Crenna was in that. I love Richard Crenna.
So handsome.
Why are they talking about ejaculate all the time?
So are they gay or...
I want to be gay with you, Jack.
We know.
Oh,
we do.
Try to hide it for a while. It's not a boner. It's just a pleat in the pants.
From what I've heard from your wife, I wouldn't be able to tell otherwise.
Damn it.
Matt's hide the boner game where he always wins.
Really good at hiding it in my waistband. Yeah, let's not talk about my dick for like 5 minutes.
All right, I'm setting a timer.
Timer. 5 minutes are on the clock.
And this is not Matt's penis percentile. My name is Jack.
My name is also Jack.
Fuck both of you.
Matt, you have said surprisingly little about Leviathan. Why did you really not like this movie?
Are you the host now?
Yes.
Okay.
This someone's going to get us
this that
This
is track. Matt's not penis percentile. I am the host.
I'm your host, Jack. wait, what was the question?
Why did you really just not like this movie?
Huh.
You know, wrestlers in it?
Family Feud. No, what's the number one answer? What was the worst part of this movie?
So to be perfectly honest, yes, I've said this movie is a pile of shit, but like the more I think about it, like I don't think I really hated it as much as I thought I was going to hate it.
You know, the point where we lost Matt was when they went on a tear and they made it seem like vodka was somehow bad.
See, I don't like vodka. I'm a whiskey guy, so I don't care. The really only thing that I have to complain about in this movie is just how slow it felt. Because I was like 25 minutes into it, and I remember checking to see how much time was left because I wanted to make sure I got it watched before we recorded. And I just felt like this should be further along in the movie.
This scares me as a writer and as a budding filmmaker. You know, I want to make movies, and I'm worried that my aesthetic, what I like from movies, most people don't. So what I'm going to make, people won't like. Because one of my favorite parts of reading, watching movies, anything, is losing myself in the world. I like slow first acts. I actually really liked Interstellar, the Christopher Nolan movie that pretty much everybody was disappointed by. I loved the first hour, basically before they go to space. I thought it was a great movie. And I just had an argument on Facebook because I defend the hell out of Star Trek The Motion Picture, which is notoriously slow. I really don't – like that's to me, I almost enjoy the slow stuff more. That's why I was hoping I was going to like Batman vs. Superman. I like the setting the table. I like setting the chess pieces. The action, the climax, the stuff that comes after that is almost an afterthought.
See, I'm not saying that it has to be like shit needs to blow up and everyone needs to die. Like, setting the table is fine and introducing the characters and all that is
fine. Although both those things happen in this.
They do, actually. I don't know. It just felt like
this is a short movie. It's like an hour 40, and pretty much the first hour is setting the table. The monster doesn't show up until relatively late, and then they're pretty much picked off right away, and the movie wraps things up. Kind of like Alien.
Yeah, I mean, it feels a lot like Alien, and if you watch Alien again, it's going to seem like a very slow movie.
Yeah, especially compared to the modern-day classic Aliens vs. Predator Requiem.
No, God. Which is going to feel like a you're sitting in a black room because you can't see shit that's going on the screen. No, I think the slowest part about this movie was probably the scene where Daniel Stern falls over the edge and Amanda Pays has to go looking for him, and that seems to take a high amount of time that wasn't necessarily well spent. Yeah. But otherwise, I think the buildup of everything that happens before that, it's just strange that it comes down to we drank mystery liquid from a flask and now we're all going to die because of it.
Yeah, assuming most of your listeners haven't seen the movie, basically they drink this poison vodka from this Russian ship where the Russian soldiers were being experimented on with the poison vodka. And they find the flask, two of them drink it and get infected. But they originally found a full bottle, and Peter Weller had swapped it out with water so that they wouldn't drink it. So wouldn't you be worried that there'd still be some residual...
Right, yeah, it's not like you rinse it out really good before...
Like, I don't think he was disinfecting this vodka bottle for this, for lack of a better word, prank. Yeah, I don't know, but that's really nitpicking.
And that's kind of what I kept waiting for to happen, is that, sure, there's going to be a point where everybody else who drank this is going to start to show similar symptoms, maybe at a slower rate, yeah, but... Because there's specifically, they make Amanda Pays' character and Peter Weller's character and the doctor don't drink it.
Yeah, exactly. I was expecting the same thing. It's like, oh, so they'll be immune. But no, that doesn't happen.
And we do see Hector Elizondo start to change eventually, but that was probably as much from the scraping of his chest by the creature than anything. And we never find out if Ernie Hudson gets it.
And he dies from a very, 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 like, straight out of the thing where Michael Carmine is being interned, and he holds his hand up, and his hand turns into a mouth, and bites Hector Elizondo. It's like that was straight out of the thing. As much as this movie owes to Alien, it certainly just felt like the thing underwater.
Yeah, and the creature was. I mean, they didn't focus on the creature very much, and there were multiples of them too, which is another thing. Yeah. But that scene where they're looking down the hallway and they see the doc's face. And like, oh, look, it's the doc. And then they kind of realize that it's not. That was pretty creepy.
Yeah, although it was super creepy. Although, I guess depending on the lighting of the hallway, wouldn't you... We see a close-up of Richard Crenna's face, but right. Wouldn't they just see a giant monster with a face in the belly?
Yeah. No, that's true. Oh, it's Doc. He looks bloated.
How did he get infected? Because they just cut to him, and I actually remember this shot from childhood that it used to always creep me out, where he's just like leaning up against the pipes, just holding his stomach in horrible pain. And I, for some reason, that shot was one of the few I remembered from this movie. It's just really creepy. But then we never see him again. The next time we see him, he's the monster.
Right.
How did he turn?
I don't know, and it seems to happen very fast, whereas everybody else was not quite that fast. So that's a good question.
Daniel Stern drank the most, and he doesn't even turn. He dies and then turns.
Right. Interesting. And
I thought that was weird. I mean, it seems like everyone turned in a different a different fashion. Yeah.
That was a creepy shot, though. That was a really well done shot where he's dead. They're hiding it from the crew. He's in a body bag in the infirmary, and Ernie Hudson comes to apologize to him or talk to him, see if he's okay. And the monster is starting to come alive and writhing under the sheets. And Ernie Hudson thinks he's just kind of waking up. I thought that was really creepy. So he's talking to him for a few minutes, and you're, as the audience, you're going, oh, he's talking to this dead body, and he doesn't realize it. And then when it moves, you're like, holy shit. But you still know more than Ernie Hudson. I thought it was just a really well-executed scene.
Yeah. Although it seemed like everybody leaving people alone in the infirmary to go and hang out when they're trying to hide the fact that this guy's dead was not well thought out.
No. Hit and miss, this movie.
Yeah, I will never watch it again. I could have gone never watching it in my life, but...
I told you this when I suggested this movie. I have a soft spot and a knack, and I'm sure this is more nostalgia than anything, for late 80s, early 90s movies. There's just something about them, and I'm probably wrong because this is, I guess, from my subjective point of view, but to me it feels like this was the first time Hollywood movies were becoming modern, like modern movies, but they're still very dated. And I just find something really fascinating in the duality of that. Even if you watch something which I considered up until very recently very modern, Independence Day, which is 96. That's 20 years ago now. But to me, that was like a modern state-of-the-art movie when it came out. And now you're watching it, and it's so dated with like the title credits exploding and the music. And I don't know. I just find something very, very fascinating. I try to get people – this is why I picked it, because I finally had an excuse to make people watch a movie with me. I always want to bring friends over and make them watch these kinds of movies, and I realized it's hard to do because I don't have friends. But there's movies I stumble across. There's a movie I've been dying to watch, but I don't want to watch it by myself. I want somebody to experience it with me because I know it's going to be fascinating, and it's called Stockholm Shakedown. It's called Shakedown, and it's with Peter Weller and Sam Elliott, and it's like a dramatic buddy cop movie, and it's like, that's all I need to know. I just know that that's going to be fascinating, and I want to watch that with somebody. And I made my best friend watch DC Cab the other day, nice. Which is an early 80s movie that apparently is more well-known than I expected. I had never heard of it, and it's such a tonally complete bonkers movie. Sometimes it's a drama, sometimes it's a comedy. It's the only like Mr. T vehicle besides Rocky III. It's an ensemble. It's got a young Adam Baldwin. And to me, this was just such a weird movie, and it's only... It's like if a tree falls in the woods and nobody's around to hear it, did it make a sound? It's like, is a movie really, really fucking weird if you were the only one to experience, like, to see it? Like, it to me, there's no point in seeing a weird movie like that unless somebody was sitting next to me going, holy shit, that was fucking weird. That was a totally off movie.
My uncle refuses to work on Elvis's birthday. It's like Gary Busey in DC Cab.
Yes.
I think this is a... This is a sign of, if we had this movie made today, one, like Matt, a lot of people would find it slow, but it would be considered artistically a better sci-fi movie than 90% of the stuff that seems to be coming out. And yeah. People would be very impressed with it. But I think at the time that it came out, it looked lowbrow compared to the stuff that had preceded it, and that's why it wasn't successful. I think you're absolutely right. It's a moment in time of where this was when cinema was still... They were still fucking trying. And now they've realized that they don't need to try. They just give people the easiest venue of, like, explosions, chick on motorcycle, and call it sci-fi. They hang little things around it to make it seem like a sci-fi movie. And it's not. This was doing things that were evocative of a lot of other films, and that's the worst thing you can say about it. But it's well acted. The people who were in it were 100% authentic. All the characters, to me, had something. Just the fact that the one character kept talking about how when they got out of there, he was going to go to Switzerland. And they're like, you don't know anything about Switzerland. You don't know anything about skiing. It didn't matter, because that was his dream. And you felt like you understood who these characters were. Daniel Stern was the only one that was like a real caricature.
Yeah.
The filthy guy who's like constantly, he's pulling pranks on people, and he's trying to whip his dick out in front of everybody.
It's basically Matt.
I was going to say he's Matt. that's why we showed you this, Matt. This is an intervention.
Yeah. Very elaborate, long-winded way, but here we are. We think we've come to talk to you. Matt, you have to stop taking your penis out.
Moment where he legitimately gives somebody crabs and just...
It's sad, but you're 100% right about how Hollywood kind of stopped trying. I never thought of it that way, but I guess because blockbuster filmmaking, the Jaws, Star Wars, modern blockbusters, we know it. I guess it was even in 1989, it was still relatively new, so it was gradually getting to that point. But you're right, and we've just come so far from there now that everything literally is franchise, remake, reboot, sequel. That's kind of sad that. I mean, there's movies here and there. We mentioned Green Room and even some movies that don't necessarily succeed, like 10 Cloverfield Lane, stuff like that. There are still original movies out there, but they're not the big budget movies. They're not the big studio movies. They're kind of the ones you have to find.
Yeah, but I think that's kind of the point, is that we're getting more of this kind of stuff happening now, but we're seeing it in streaming more. We're seeing it in TV shows more. Yeah. That's where people are going for content that they can feel attachment to, because movies, they just like, well, we got 2 hours to get their attention and fill them up and send them out the door. But
the TV stuff is the things where we can really tell a story and we can stretch it out and we can explore the characters and their motivations more and we can explore the plot better. And as long as it's something that's not going like full 24 episodes a season where they have to do too many things and they have to stretch it too thin, yeah, some of the better stuff is coming out now, I think, is more evocative of this than any of the films are.
Yeah, as a writer, and I kind of try to write when I do write. I haven't written in a long time, but I still call myself a writer. I because I'm a lover of films, lover of movies, that's why I guess I started storytelling from a young age. So that's a long way of saying I don't have a favorite genre because I love all genres. I love horror. I love sci-fi. I love comedy. I primarily seem to go towards sci-fi because it just seems more fun to write. I want to write the great American novel, but that certainly seems like more work than fun. But when I come up with a cool concept, so usually sci-fi, fantasy, something like that, I do struggle with, do I want to make this a movie or do I want to make this a TV pilot? Because you're right, there's just something about long-form storytelling that's so much more appealing. But at the same time, you know, Back to the Future is my favorite movie of all time. Would that have been better as a five-season cable TV series? Probably not.
Right.
So it's always hard as a content creator what medium fits this story best? And I always found that a very fascinating question. Like, would Leviathan have been better as a 13-episode cable miniseries? Again, then maybe it's because I do like the slow, long burn. It's probably not. Probably that would make the problems that Matt had with it, and I think most people have with it, worse.
I think that it could do both, because I think that the parts that I enjoyed are the parts that I think you enjoyed. I think it was the better part of the movie when it was moving slower and it was exploring these people. But as soon as the creature gets introduced, it goes really fast. All of the stuff that happens with them, finding it, fighting it, everything else, maybe moves a little too quick for me, and I would have liked it to be that we've had one person get infected, and you know we've seen what happens to them, and the other people, like the decision that Bridget has of, like, she sees Buzz's or Sixpack's transformation, and she realizes that that's happening to her, so just immediately she goes and kills herself. Yeah. And I feel like we would have gotten a little bit more time to explore why she felt that was immediately what she had to do. You know, she's not working with the doctor at all. She doesn't take any second chance of, like, you know, can I heal from this? It's just she's so freaked out and she does that. And I think a show maybe would have given us a little bit more room.
Yeah, that's a really powerful moment. We're talking about how mostly this movie is unoriginal. It's borrowing from other movies. And that's one of the few times it bucks that trend where it goes, all right, now we know she's the second one to die. She was the second one infected. She's going to get the snowball effect going. This is how these movies play out. And the fact that she stops that and takes some agency and actually kills herself, that was genuinely surprising. I thought they were going to find her in the shower. It's filled with steam. I thought it was going to be the classic, oh, my God, she's transformed. She's a monster. Now we know there's a monster in our midst. And no, they find her with her wrist slit open. It was dark.
Yeah.
I do think you're right. They whiff the action. Do you think the third act with the monster scenes and it failed pretty much completely? Do you think it was because there was no good way to show the monster for too long because it would give it away, or it would look too corny, look too fake? You know, basically hide the shark like in Jaws. And so because of that limitation, they couldn't come up with good action. Although I guess Alien doesn't show the alien in that exact same third act type of scene, and they do a Ridley Scott does a much, much better job.
Yeah, well, I mean, also Ridley Scott had the alien designed by Geiger, or Giger, so that's a different standout. You introduce that creature, and that creature just immediately that's a selling point for the film. If nothing else, you go there and you see what was such an original concept of what an alien would look like and what an alien would act like. And this is sort of akin to The Blob and to what we'd seen in The Thing, and it's a little bit less of a surprise at that point, so I don't think they concentrated on it as much, but it really feels like they wrote these characters into a story and then they said, well, we're going to turn this into an action horror film now, and they introduced the creature part, because a lot of the other parts of it don't need that as a component.
Yeah, That's a good point. Although now you make me, now I really wish like Hasbro had come out with a Leviathan action figure and you could swap out like Richard Crenna and Daniel Stern's faces on the torso. You know, collect them all.
That, yeah, that would be like a Mr. Potato Head, except gross.
They should have, I mean, I don't want to give a multi-billion dollar company billion dollar ideas here, but they should totally make like a Walking Dead potato, the Walking Spud. Make like a Walking Dead Mr. Potato Head where you can like pull out like the disgusting eyes and the skeleton face. I feel like that would be a huge hit with people.
I have a feeling my wife is going to wind up drawing that later on today.
Oh, that would make me very happy if she did. It's a shame I don't have any position of power where I can pitch these ideas and get paid for it. But here we are.
Here we are.
You're on a soapbox internet situation, so you have more power than you know.
Besides Sylvester Stallone, are your six followers? Are they the president of Hasbro and?
Yeah, the president of Hasbro. Obama, Sylvester Stallone, Jesus,
the Brexit mayor.
Yeah, Brexit mayor.
Oh, and Chris Elliott came over to our show from my appearance on yours.
I actually, I had to turn him away. I was like, we can't be having people of your likes.
Send your daughter.
Send your daughter. We like to keep it classy around here.
All right, let's score this. We already know that Matt is going to give this a very high rewatchability score, but from 0 to 5, Jack, how would you feel that you want to rank Leviathan?
In rewatchability?
Yes.
0 to 5, right?
Yep.
I would watch this movie once every 5-6 years. I wouldn't put it on more than that. It's funny, I don't rewatch anything anymore. I feel like ever since streaming became a thing, I just stopped. It's like, I can't watch this again. I have to watch something new. I'm going to go 2.5. I'll go down the middle.
Matt?
Two decimals?
No. Yeah, the 0.5 is fine. You already know my answer.
That would be a 0.
0.
I will go 2 on this. I will say it was nice to re-see it after not seeing it for so long. And it held up better than I probably would have thought. If somebody just said, oh yeah, Leviathan's on cable, you want to watch it, I would have been like, fucking Leviathan, that piece of shit. But it wasn't as much of a piece of shit as I would have expected it to be rewatching it. Like, and I would have criticized myself for enjoying it in the first place and then gone, oh wait, I was stupid, this is great.
But back to what I was saying before, this is, I probably wouldn't want to watch it by myself every few years. Maybe bump it up to every 10 years. But I would want to watch this with somebody who hasn't seen it before, just to get their reaction. I could watch a movie over and over in that case. So 2.5 with the caveat that I'm rewatching it with someone who hasn't seen it before.
Yeah, it's someone new. My wife had actually just watched it right before I went to watch it. She's like, oh yeah, I just saw that was in the Roku, and so I watched it. I'm like, oh well, great. Well, I'm gonna watch it now, and she goes, great. We'll watch it again. Yeah, so
she would give it a high rewatchability.
She would definitely rewatch it a couple of times. But her favorite movie is The Thing.
Okay, that's up there for me. That's certainly one of my favorites.
All right, so story 0 through 5.
It's not very original. I do like that they're. Well, I was going to say that they're trapped underwater with the hurricane that's faked, but if you're in a space station, you're just as isolated. 1.5.
Yeah, I'll go 3 just because I think that the story of the characters is really good.
Yeah.
But the story of, you know, how it completes is really bad.
It's that's
like
a good point.
Stephen King thing. It's
I'll bump it up.
All great character interaction until it's yeah. Like, well, now we have to fucking resolve this.
That's a good point. I'm going to bump it up to 2.5. Matt, I'm going to smack in the face, Matt, if you make another condescending sigh.
Not with a cock like you want.
Not with a cock. It's going to be with a vagina. I'm going to smack in the face with a vagina.
Them's fighting words.
You can just slap me with a salmon, too. I guess story, I would go like a 2. It wasn't terrible. It wasn't the best. Wasn't original.
Reasonable.
Reasonable, yeah.
No, I mean your score.
Oh.
I'm very impressed to get a 2 out of you.
Wow.
The belligerent Matt. Scariness.
I was going to make a poop reference, but...
Me too, I let it go.
no pun intended.
Yeah, I read it.
Scariness, 0 through 5, Jack.
Boy, you know... All right, I'm going to rank this one from 5-year-old Jack, so I'm going to give it a 2.5. Sometimes it's creepy, like you said, the Richard Crenna shot. There's just this inherent creepiness. There's really no big scares. 2.5.
Matt?
Zero.
I will go to it. Well, you know, you just never know when random sharks are going to show up, so that's all. It wasn't super scary. It wasn't even as creepy as I would have liked from this kind of creature.
Yeah.
Seeing the transformation happen to Daniel Stern's character, it happened so much undercover, literally, that I would have liked to have seen more of that on screen.
Yeah.
And then by the time we see the creature starting to form, it's two bodies in a body bag that they try to push over the edge and then just an arm crawling out. And at least we get multiple creatures.
Yeah.
But I would have liked to have seen multiple creatures happening at the same time. And kind of like getting pincered in, like what happens in Aliens, if you're going to rip off stuff, take the best parts of them.
Yeah, and differentiate the creatures. Maybe one becomes like a crab, one becomes more of a barracuda, because they're going with this nautical theme. I just harping on what you said about it could have been scarier. Jerry Goldsmith did the soundtrack for this movie. He did a lot of famous scores. He did the famous score.
The music is good.
A lot was said about how he incorporated whale sounds into the score. And it is interesting, but that's not super scary. Whales aren't scary to me. It's almost like that would have been better for a pirate movie or some kind of that's lost at sea movie, something else ocean related, not monster movie.
Yeah.
I felt like that the score could have been scarier.
Yeah, I didn't really get scary from it, but it kind of reminded me at the end, watching the ending credits and listening to the music, it reminded me of watching the original Poltergeist, because that music felt very tra-la-la, like the Smurfs. At the end, after all these horrible things that have just happened, and I guess it's supposed to be evocative of suburbia.
Yeah.
But this isn't suburbia, so it didn't quite work in that theme.
Yeah, totally agreed.
I guess. You can contact us by leaving us a voicemail at 805-328-3966. You can email us at pot@gncast.com or just leave us a message on our website. I can tell when Corey writes shit, because these aren't words I would ever use. But simply put, we want to hear from you. Seriously, though, we want to hear from you. But you can let us know your favorite part of the show. Maybe you want to hear more about my penis, less about my penis.
dick jokes. Pictures of his penis.
Yeah, there's dick pics. You can add me on Snapchat.
There's also, you guys have on your website, a PDF of a restraining order from Matt. You can just fill in the blanks.
Fill it out, mail it into your local police jurisdiction. I'll get that on file, and then I can't come anywhere near you. There's something else you want us to do differently, better, just basically let us know. We're trying to make the show better for you guys. You can follow us on Twitter and Instagram at PodcastTerror, and also subscribe to the podcast via iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, and any of your favorite podcatchers. Leave us feedback, preferably 4 stars, even though after listening to this you may not feel five stars. 4 stars might be worthy after this conversation. But all subscription options and links can be found at gncast.com/subscribe, and you can join us on our Facebook page under Galactic Netcasts. Jack, I wish there was.
I will follow you. You were talking to me. I thought you were talking to the listeners. That was all directly to me. It's like, oh, okay.
Yeah,
I realized someone else would be involved.
I haven't been recording any of this. This is not actually a show. I just we just want you to follow us.
Jack, we're in the house.
Jack, I'm lonely. That's fine.
Turn around. I'm inside you. Jack, where can people find you and all of the things that you do?
At the bus stop. I'm at Jackie No Breaks on Twitter. You can follow my podcasts at 90s Percentile and at Worst Episode Pod, which I highly recommend if you are a Simpsons fan. We love the show, but we talk about how terrible it's got. I would love to get both of you guys on at least 90s Percentile, because that's the only one recording at the moment. I would love to tag team. I'd love to get you guys on together because you work so well together. You guys got a great chemistry. But if schedules don't work out, I'd love to have at least one of you on your own.
Yeah, I was going to say how much I love your camaraderie with Dan on your show. But then getting you over here, I realized, oh, maybe you don't need Dan.
Fuck Dan.
You get two different things. It's two different, like we've had Matt on, we've had Corey on, and you guys are so much fun. And then having you guys together, it's its own thing.
No, I really like being on things with Matt. I have a lot of fun that way. But I was super nervous about being on 90s Percentile without him because he leads a lot of the conversation here. And I had such a great time, and he fed me so much stuff to make me feel better about it going in. Then even afterwards, he's like, yeah, I think you did okay, buddy.
You did great. That was a really fun show. I'm glad to hear you say that, though, because I actually kind of felt the same way. I've done other podcasts, but this is probably one of my bigger appearances without Dan, basically, since we teamed up together. So I was also wondering, it's like, oh, man, maybe the only reason people do like me is my proximity to Freet. You know, so I hope I did an okay job without Dan.
No, you did a great job. And I think it also helps that we're both big fans of your work anyway. So we already feel a connection to you. I mean, 90s Percentile has gone up to the top of my list of podcasts I listen to week after week, whether I'm on there or not. But it is a little bit easier to hear my precious tones. But I love that show. And I love the way that you guys sound together. And it is like what we try to do here. Matt and I, when we met up and we started doing this, we didn't know each other very well. And I look forward to every moment I get to be on air with Matt, or even us just talking to each other privately now, because I have such a great time with them. And that's something that you can't make happen. That just, it's natural, yeah, or it's not.
It's natural or it's not, exactly. I mean, you can improve upon it. You can find what works and then play to the strengths, but yeah, there's definitely a certain natural chemistry to it. I think the name of our third podcast that we're going to do together, our miscellaneous movie podcast, should just be called Circle Jerks.
Yes.
And then it's like 50% we talk about whatever the fuck we feel like, because we all get along, and 50% just jerking each other off and telling it just a big love fest.
So where do we talk about the movies in there?
We don't,
okay.
It's just a premise to hang your hat on.
Yeah. Exactly. Or,
it's a beautiful lie.
So is this like a 47-second podcast? Because that's all I got in me.
Well, we could do like the 90s percentile style. We can put a big giant clock on the wall.
And we can put a big 90s percentile refractory.
We could do it.
Let's make it happen, guys.
Yeah, even if we just do it like once a month, once every 6 weeks, something like that, just once in a while.
I say that we pick a movie, we say that that's a movie we're going to do, we don't do it the first episode, and then the second episode, like, okay, we're going to do the movie now, we don't do it that episode, and we just keep pushing the movie back as far as we can.
All right, I have a crazy idea. What if we did like a serial type show where it's one story told over 13 episodes, and we literally pick one movie, and we work our way up to it over the course of 13 weekly episodes of a podcast. Basically, my long-form storytelling, you know, should this be a podcast or should this be a 13-episode cable series? We combine them. We do a 13-hour weekly podcast where we eventually talk about a really random movie.
I'm not even going to bullshit here. I think we got together and we discussed on air what our proposed script is for Gremlins 3.5. That would make a pretty fucking good show.
All right, what if we do a 13-episode weekly podcast, an hour each episode, and we just break down Gremlins 3 over the course of 13 hours. Would you guys be in?
Yeah, absolutely. Are we going to review it like it's actually happened?
That could be our season finale, or we could have an after show podcast with Chris Hardwick talking Grems.
Talking Grems. Oh, God. Yeah, we'll have to figure something out.
Matt's going to dress up like the female gremlin for the last show.
Shut up, don't. You have to wheel me in because I won't be able to walk.
Can we all hang out? Can we all meet up in the city and hang out on Halloween and we'll all dress up as different gremlins from Gremlins 2?
Sure.
I want to be the brain one. Just if only so I could have... Was he the one with the trench coat? Or no, there was a Flasher with it.
There was a Flasher gremlin.
I want to be the Flasher gremlin.
I think I'm going to be the vegetable one.
Just use those sores on your body to your advantage.
Pretty much. Hey, what?
Huh?
It's a nice cauliflower-like cluster.
Oh, come on. God dang it.
Is that what your wife calls your penis, the cauliflower?
Come on.
Corey, what you get for bleaching your pubes, Matt. You opened yourself up.
Turned into a horrible, horrible acid burn, rendering my penis pretty much useless. Corey, where can people find you on the internet?
You can see the comics that I help post and blog for and sometimes write at donutscomics.com.
You can follow me on Instagram and Twitter at Matt the Lifeguard. So that'll probably wrap it up. I'm going to stop this before we talk too much more about my penis, but thank you very much for listening to another episode of the podcast here, and we will talk to you guys next week. All right.